Good morning, everybody, and welcome. It's really great to be with you this morning. And if this is your first time with us, you are so, so welcome. Today, we're going to spend a little bit of time worshipping, and Dave's going to be leading us in that. And then they're going to hand back over to me. I'm going to bring some notices. And then after that, I'm going to hand over to Andy, who's going to bring the word. So this morning, let's hand over to Dave so that he can bring the worship.
Hi, everyone. Good morning. Before we start, I just want to say a very well-known verse from Romans, Bible, says that Romans chapter 8, verse 8. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things come, powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God. Amazing truth there. There is nothing that can separate. I think it would just do us really good to focus on that. Nothing that's going on at the moment is separating us from God. While we could focus on lost in these times, there is, you know, one thing that we have not lost. That's our ability to connect God Himself. Done for us. We're going to start this morning. We're going to worship God. We're going to sing from the north to the south. I thought this song just a great one, considering that we are gathering together with people across the world here. So we've got people joining us from the Philippines every week. Elsewhere, good song, just celebrating God throughout the earth. From the north to the south, from the east and the west, Lord, your name will be praised throughout all of the earth. Every tribe and every tongue, they will come and bow down and confess Jesus is Lord, the great King over all. Let the nations be glad. Thank you. tribe, every tribe and every tongue, they will come and bow down and confess Jesus is Lord, the great King over all. Let the nations be glad. Yes, Father God, we lift our eyes to you this morning. We worship you. We want to lift your name higher. God, we thank you that nothing is separating us from you. We can worship you today the same as we ever have. Father God, I pray you'd be with each one of us this morning. Bring praise to your name. Focus on you. In the darkness we were waiting. In the darkness we were waiting. Without hope and without light. Till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the one. From a throne of endless glory. To a cradle in the dirt. Praise the we to focus on God, where you are, wherever you are, there's no barrier between you and God right now. You can meet with him, he will meet with you, and that is the glorious truth that we celebrate as Christians, because of what Jesus has done for us. We now have access to God the Father. I'm going to play a bit more and just take some time to yourself with God. Say whatever it is that you need to say to him. Maybe that's an expression of worship, maybe that's an expression of thanks for something that he's done for you. Maybe you need to say sorry for something. Take a moment now, wherever you are. Thank you. Thank you, God, that you are with us. God, that you are working through us, working in. Sung worship to question our ears, but say to us, be with us, continue, shape us,
Hi everyone. It is awesome, isn't it, to be able to come together and worship, even in these difficult circumstances, just to be able to worship. And much as it's great to be able to be, I'm really looking forward to the days where we can all be back together and worship God, and collectively. And at the moment, this is where we're at, and I just love it that we can still come together. Really, really great. I'm gonna show you the newest member of Open Door Church. He has been asleep, so I'm actually going to move the laptop. So here he is. Hello. That is Ozzy, and he is the newest member of ODC. If you want to see him a bit more, join us afterwards when we have coffee, because I'm pretty sure he will be with us then. He's definitely going to be with me, but he can make an appearance, and yeah. So I've got a few notices for this week coming. Please remember we've got our small groups on Tuesdays and Wednesdays. If you're not a member of the church and you're just kind of hooking up with us online, just ping something onto the Facebook page. And if you'd like to join one of the life groups, or sorry, one of the small groups on a Tuesday or a Wednesday, just ping something out, and me or Loretta or Andy or one of us will get back to you with some more information. So that's a Tuesday and a Wednesday if you'd like to join. Also, we have a prayer meeting. Guys, come and join us for the prayer meeting. It's a great place. It's the place where we can fuel the tank. You know, we can be alive in God, and we can just open our voices together, and we can give praise and thanks to him, and we can pray for some of these big things that are going on at the moment. So yeah, come and join us there as well. So I'm going to pray for Andy, who is now going to come and open God's word for us. He's going to preach from John. So let me just pray. Father, I just pray, Lord, we open your word, that as Andy communicates your word to us, Lord, that you totally speak through him, Lord. Lord, I pray that you'd speak to us as a church or as a family together. But Lord, I also pray that you'd speak to us individually. Lord, allow your word to be the instrument, Lord, that tests us and allows us to seek things and see things in different ways, Lord. Your word is awesome, and we just pray for your word to be opened in Jesus' name. Amen. Hand over to Andy now.
Good morning! Good morning, Open Door Church. Andy here, and to all of you in the internet world that are listening to this morning's broadcast. Fantastic that you're coming to worship with us here in Sunbury. Last week, Oliver Elliott found himself a lectern, and lots of people said, "Oh, Ollie, that's a fabulous lectern. Oh, you're a lovely lectern." And I thought, well, that's not good enough. I mean, somehow I've got to outdo the young fella. So I thought, well, I know how. I'm going to broadcast from the Open Door Church Centre. I'm here, but you're not, sadly. But hopefully at some point soon, one day, we will all be back together by God's grace. Amen. Last week we heard from Uncle Nigel. It was great to have Nigel preach us again with a fabulous word. If you've not heard it, please go back on YouTube or on the Open Door Church website, www.opendoorchurchsunbury.com, and have a listen to that word. It will do you good. Next week, very interesting topic of dealing with anxiety and coping with that. And during this lockdown time, that would be a really important lesson for us to learn. And Ollie's going to be bringing that to us next week. So tune in. But this week, we're going to continue on our series, Preaching Through the Gospel of John, which we did before we were in lockdown and we're doing now we're in lockdown. And we've come to John chapter 16. So please turn in your Bibles to John 16, verses 16 to 33. It will come up on the PowerPoint. Let's read together. Jesus went on to say, "In a little while you will see me no more, and then after a while you will see me." At this, some of the disciples said to one another, "What does he mean by saying, 'In a little while you will see me no more, and then in a little while you will see me, and because I'm going to the Father'?" They kept asking, "What does he mean by 'a little while'? We don't understand what he is saying." Jesus saw that they wanted to ask him about this, so he said to them, "Are you asking one another what I meant when I said, 'In a little while you will see me no more, and then after a little while you will see me'? Very truly I tell you, you will weep and mourn while the world rejoices. You will grieve, but your grief will turn to joy. A woman giving birth to a child has pain because her time has come. But when her baby is born, she forgets the anguish because of her joy that a child is born into the world. So with you. Now is your time of grief. But I will see you again and you will rejoice. And no one will take away your joy. In that day, you will no longer ask me anything. Very truly, I tell you, my Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. Until now, you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask, and you will receive, and your joy will be complete. Though I have been speaking figuratively, a time is coming when I will no longer use this kind of language, but will tell you plainly about my Father. In that day, you will ask in my name. I'm not saying that I will ask the Father on your behalf. No, the Father himself loves you because you love me and have believed that I came from God. I came from the Father and entered the world. Now I'm leaving the world and going back to the Father." Then the disciples said, "Well, now you're speaking clearly and without figures of speech. Now we can see that you know all things and that you do not even need to have anyone ask you questions. This makes us believe that you came from God. Do you now believe?" Jesus replied, "A time is coming, and in fact has come, when you will be scattered, each to your own home. You will leave me all alone. Yet I am not alone, for my Father is with me. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world." Would you pray after me? Father God, speak to my heart and change my life, even in this lockdown period, that you may be glorified. In Jesus' name. Amen, amen. Amen. Thank you for praying. The first thing that we find in this passage is we don't understand what is going on sometimes. So here we are in the narrative of the Gospel of John, and firstly we learn that although Jesus is about to head to the cross and unfold the whole plan of salvation for mankind, his disciples just don't understand him a lot of the time. They didn't understand what Jesus was really talking about. They were confused. They didn't get it. You see, their thoughts on a Messiah wasn't a Messiah that would head towards Jerusalem, towards a cross, die and was resurrected. Their understanding of a Messiah was of an all-conquering king and ruler to re-establish the nation state of Israel. We read this in Acts chapter 1, verse 6, where they ask the resurrected Jesus, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? No, your thinking's all wrong. You don't understand. You have not got a clue, you bunch. You haven't got a clue. What is wrong with you? They didn't understand. And that's because everything they were taught, everything they experienced up to this point, didn't agree with the understanding of what the Messiah would be compared to what the Messiah was going to be. Now, have you seen this recently that, honestly, a lot of the time we have no understanding of what is going on? At this point, have you been on listening to the news, the Sky News, the BBC News? You will see professors in immunology and virology, viruses and immunity, talking for their 15 minutes of fame, as Andy Warhol once famously said, about all the intrinsic details about the virus and how it's spread from one to the other and what the virus does to your body. And you can see the BBC news guy just trying to interrupt this fellow because he's in full flow about his topic that he knows everything about. And the whole of the country has no idea, or at least 50% understanding of what the guy was talking about. This is what it's a bit like. Or recently, you don't understand when it's to do with IT. Have any of you had that issue? I certainly have. I mean, when it comes to Zoom meetings, well, what you've got to do now is you've got to share your screen to multi-participate and then mute all your Zoom in chat so that your virtual background doesn't end up in the waiting room. What? I don't understand what you're talking about. I don't understand. In this lockdown, we just don't understand what is going on a lot of the time. The disciples didn't understand what God was doing, and right now at times we don't understand as well. Lord, what are you doing? We don't understand what he's saying, they said. Verse 16 to 18, they're very confused. Well, in a little while you'll see me no more, and then after a little while you will see me, and because I'm going to the Father. Some have said this is an explanation about clearly about the next few days, that verse 16, that Jesus was heading to the cross, and then for a little while they'd see him, and then he would die, and they wouldn't see him, and then they'd see him again, and they would have joy because he's resurrected. Some say, like Augustine and Calvin, that this is more about that they saw Jesus, and the time when they didn't see him was the church age, our age, the time between the first and the second coming of Christ. So that when Jesus returns, they will see him again. I think that's stretching the narrative a little bit. I like the first explanation. That seems the clearest to me. That Jesus was heading towards the cross. And because he was heading towards the cross, there would come a time when they wouldn't see him. And then they would see him again. And then the Messiah who would die and be buried and then raised from the dead would then send that other counselor, John 14, verse 16, the promised Holy Spirit. But this isn't going to be the all-conquering, victorious Messiah that the disciples had in mind. It was not the role the Messiah, they thought the Messiah would have. They did not want an arrested Messiah, a tortured Messiah, a dead Messiah. That was something they would never have predicted nor accepted. Philip Yancey writes, from Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and Joseph, Moses, David, and a host of others, I learn that God moves in a way I could neither predict nor desire. That's so true. We often cannot fathom what God is doing. I often think that the disciples didn't have a clue of what Jesus was saying or what God was about to accomplish. They couldn't even contemplate it. They couldn't even reason it because it was just so outside of their understanding of how God would work to date. It's like a situation that they just can't get their heads around. A bit like a coronavirus. We just can't get our heads around what is going on in our world and what is God doing? But I tell you what, friends, he is doing something. Tim Keller writes in his excellent book, Walking with God Through Pain and Suffering, this. He writes, with time and perspective, most of us can see good reason for at least some of the tragedy in our life. Why could it not be possible that from God's vantage point, there is good reason for all of them? We question what this coronavirus is about and what is going on. We hear people getting infected. We hear people dying. And we think, oh, Lord, what are you doing? What is going on? What is going on in our world? What is going on in our country that has been so badly affected here in the UK? Well, we must somehow in this period expect that God is doing something. God is trying to teach us something, trying to lead us into something, so that we may become more wholehearted for him. Christians are a bit like nails. If you hit nail hard, it goes deeper into the wood. The harder you hit Christians, the deeper they go into God. That is just a truth. C.H. Spurgeon writes, brethren, the knife of affliction is sharp but salutary. You cannot delight in it, but faith may teach you to value it. God does things in us in hard times. We're not masochists during this coronavirus crisis. We don't rejoice in it, but to add faith to this period removes confusion and it allows us to leave God the space to do something in our hearts and in our lives that changes us so that we may be more focused on the mission that he wants to give us in our lives from here on in. Maybe, like something here in the passage, I would suggest that God is doing something monumental in a shift in our nation and in our churches that will change the way we work from now on in. We are getting ready in this period to become a church that is right for the 21st century, wherever that may be. You see that across the country now. Church leaders and churches have changed rapidly. In weeks, we achieve things that we would never have dreamed of doing. We just wouldn't have done. And yet we had to, because suddenly the only person in the Open Door Church Centre is Andy, because he's the only one allowed in here, because he works here. You know, things God's doing to monumentally change our mission and direction on a macro scale, so that we might now in the future be more the tool that he would want for us to reach this next generation. Who knows the lessons we're going to learn through this? We're going to be talking a lot about that as a leadership team, leaders, elders, trustees, and with you all as we go forward. Who knows what God is doing? We know this, that people are finding faith in Jesus Christ through the internet. People are coming to know him by the proclamation of churches that would never have proclaimed in that way without a coronavirus crisis and a lockdown. You see, God does always more behind our backs than he does in front of our face. That is just the truth. Jesus is saying here, things disciples are going to change. It's going to look bad, but then it's going to be wonderful. So secondly, it's time to pray because we are loved. Verse 20, Jesus starts to talk about his path from here to Calvary and the cross. The world will rejoice because they want to see Jesus dead, and the disciples will grieve, but their grief will be short-lived. Verse 21 to 22, Jesus compares what will happen like the process of childbirth. That initially, there's a lot of pain when the baby comes, but then there is much joy. Now, I've actually been down there at the business end, watching both of my children be born. It's painful, people. If you've never been there, it's horrible. It's like a war zone. It's just, it's not great. My goodness, I'm so pleased I wasn't the one giving birth. Poor Nikki. At the time when my children were born, I was playing a lot of rugby. I was a rugby captain. And so it was a bit like, come on, girl, one final push. Ball coming in now. You know, no, it wasn't great, poor Nikki. It was a little bit like that. Massive pain, but then massive joy as our two little darlings were born into the world. Their picture may come up now. They haven't changed that much, I don't think. Well, not changed to me. They were cute then, and they're still cute now. So there you go. What happened? So there will be pain heading towards the cross. But in the end, their pain will be changed to joy. This is because after his death, there was a resurrection, and then the gospel went to the world. The Holy Spirit came upon the church, and our world was transformed. The wonderful Holy Spirit living inside every Christian anywhere around the world, just ministering in his name, in Jesus' name. They didn't understand what Jesus was saying to them. They didn't want Jesus to go away. They didn't want Jesus to die. They didn't understand why Jesus had to go. Therefore, Jesus introduces the fact that the Father is sending Jesus to the cross, but that because they put their faith in Jesus, the Father loves them individually. He says it's time to pray. Verse 24, until now you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you will receive, and your joy will be complete. Because of what the Son has done, because of Jesus, we can ask anything in Jesus' name, and we will have the joy of seeing God answer prayers. Now, he may not answer all prayers the way that we would like, because God sees everything that goes on and he knows everything. But we do know that he does answer prayer, and he answers prayer, verse 27, because the Father loves us. And because he loves us, he will answer prayer, because we pray in the name of his beloved Son. John Calvin writes, we have the heart of God as soon as we place before him the name of his Son. Friends, some people are asking, well, what can we do in this time of lockdown? There's no ministries going on. There's no groups going on. What can we do? Well, we can decorate the house. We can learn a course online. We can attend to our beautiful gardens. I am a part of a small group that WhatsApp pictures of plants on our small group chat. Thank you, Kevin and Barry and Cavi and Sarah Page. Bing, bing, bing. Fabulous, beautiful plants. You're doing a great job. But how much more can we pray during this time? The promise of God hearing and acting on our behalf as we pray, we intercede for him. Please remember, Jesus made this promise that God would answer their prayer to a bunch of fallible disciples who were just about to desert him. These aren't the heroes of faith he was making them to. These are people who are just about to run away. And so Jesus makes that same promise to us. We can pray. This time, I would say, is a call to prayer in lockdown. This is a challenge, particularly, friends, to older members of our congregation. I want to say this is a challenge, I believe, from God to you, because the reality is a lot of our older folk are going to be locked down for quite a while, it seems, until we get an inoculation against the coronavirus. A lot of people will be locked down. And so therefore, friends, this is a call to prayer. When I was a new Christian in Epsom Evangelical Church back in the mid-80s, there was a lady called Barbara Edwards, and she was the mother of the pastor at Hook Evangelical, I believe. And she was in my house group, as it was then. And she prayed and prayed and prayed for young people coming off the Longmead estate and going into that little church. And so many of those young people got saved. A lot of you can remember Connie Garrett. I remember going to her house with Susan Whitworth, and Connie would tell me about the people that she was praying for. You see, she prayed and prayed and prayed. Let me encourage you, older members of Open Door Church, you're not locked down for nothing. You're locked down to pray. You are the artillery now, bunkered in to bombard heaven with your prayers. You are the artillery to bombard heaven. It's so needed. Pray during this time. This is a call to prayer. Pray during the coronavirus. Pray for your family. Pray for the church. Pray for your friends. Pray for those that are not saved. Pray for the world. particularly, friends, pray for the world. They're going to suffer so badly, particularly nations that we're involved in you know, the Philippines and Liberia, Serbia, India. Pray for them. Pray for our government, our Queen and our Prime Minister and our government, Lord, in this time. Pray for unsaved people. Pray, 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 pray. It's a call to prayer, a plan to prayer. In his book, A Call to Spiritual Reformation, D.A. Carson writes, "Much prayer is not done because we do not plan to pray. We do not drift into disciplined prayer. We will not grow in prayer unless we plan to pray. That means we must self-consciously set aside time to do nothing but pray." Friends, we need to pray. God's only call to the church is for him to know him, is for them to know him more intimately, to have a more special relationship with the Father, where we do that in prayer as we come before him and come into his presence, as we tell him we love him, that we're more intimate with him because we have the time right now to do that. As Nigel spoke about last week, we can slow down now and pray. So I wonder, after Nigel said that last week, how has the last week been? Have you listened to Uncle Nigel? Because Uncle Nigel says that we need to listen to God to slow down and pray. We don't drift into prayer, as Carson said. We plan into prayer. Someone asked me this week, well, I'm going to pray. You know, is it all right if you pray for us because I want to pray about us? Yes, yes, please, please pray. Please take time out to pray. Be intentional. God loves it when you pray. Verse 27, the Father loves you. Verse 23, and when he hears your voice, he's going to answer. Maybe not always the way we think he's going to answer, but he will answer because of the intimate relationship you have with him through Jesus Christ. Lastly, remember, Jesus wins. Verse 28, Jesus tells the disciples that he came from the Father, he came into the world, and now he's leaving the world and going back to the Father. So basically, Jesus broke it down to them at a very simple level. Finally, the disciples got it. Oh, we understand now, the disciples said. Now you're speaking clearly, Jesus. Why didn't you do that before? Oh, you're speaking without figures of speech. Verse 29, now we understand all those things you were talking about. Oh, this makes us believe you came from God. One of my heroes, Bishop John Charles Ryle, wrote of this verse, like young recruits, they had to learn that it is one thing to know the soldier's drill and to wear the uniform, and quite another thing to be steadfast in battle. We know what that means. Basically, the disciples, they got the idea that Jesus was coming, but actually, when the pressure came, they ran away. Jesus knew, verse 32, that they would soon be scattered and that their exclamation of faith was just a short-lived thing. Jesus knew, Zechariah chapter 13, verse 7, strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. And that in him, right there, that prophecy would be fulfilled. This time will come to an end, Open Door Church. And there is a note of exclamation of triumph in Jesus. 32, I've told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Jesus wins, friends. We don't know why we're in this passage of history, but we do know that in the end, Christus Victor, Jesus the victor, the winner, he is the one. In this world, we will have trouble. Oh boy, we know that right now. But friends, be at peace. Jesus wins. Jesus knew, even verse 32, as he was heading towards the cross, that the Father loved him and that he would be the victor. He knew that even though everybody else left him, even though he stood alone, he was never alone because the Father was with him. That the Father loves you, verse 27 of John 16, and he will never leave you. He will never leave you alone. You are never alone because the Father is with you, His Holy Spirit living inside you. Even right now, you're not alone. Verse 33, will have lots of trouble, but take heart, Jesus said, He will overcome the world. This world will end in one way only, and that's in Jesus' return. You can be so sure of that. T.S. Eliot, in his five-part poem, The Hollow Men, writes, this is how the world ends. This is the way the world ends. This is the way the world ends, not with a bang, but a whimper. Jesus says, no, no, you will have trouble in this world. You will have wars, you will have diseases, you will have poverty and injustice and abuse and pandemic viruses, but take heart, Jesus wins. This is how, this is the way the world ends, Jesus returning. That is the way the world ends, because Jesus says, I have overcome the world. At the end of the day, it's God who writes human history, not professors in virology, not domesto-swigging American presidents, nor Wuhan presidents that think, oh, I wouldn't mind a little piece of bat, actually, for my lunch this afternoon. No! Who will finish history? Jesus will finish history. Only the triumph of Jesus, the Lamb of God, the Saviour of the world, will end history. Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising its shame, and sits down at the right hand of the throne of God, Hebrews 12, verse 2. The victory wholly is his. He will overcome and we will overcome because he has overcome the world. In fact, Revelation 15, verse 12, you will hear, worthy is the Lamb seated on the throne. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Yeah, sure, the disciples were about to be scattered, that they were going to have great trouble, and that many of those disciples went on to be martyrs, probably with the exception only of John. Many of those disciples would become martyrs. So, trouble was coming their way. And yes, there will be a time when Jesus on the cross will exclaim, it is finished, as he pays for our sin. But through that, we can come to know God. Through that, we can come to know the love of the Father. This is Jesus. This is the Saviour. This is the one who wins. Where are you at this morning? What are you fearing about the future? Be at peace. You will have trouble, but Jesus has overcome the world. And he wins. And maybe this morning you don't know Jesus. You don't know the peace of knowing a God, Holy Spirit in your heart. You haven't repented. You haven't turned around, said sorry to God for the way you've led your life or the fact that you've not acknowledged him. Well, even now, I just want to say God the Father's love is for you. If you just turn in prayer now and just talking to God and ask that you may come to know him through what Jesus did on the cross, paying the penalty for your sin and in your place taking punishment so that now you can with confidence ask for your sin to be forgiven because of all that Jesus has done. Father God, thank you that you love us. Thank you that you love Open Door Church. Thank you that you win. Thank you that, Lord, we can be confused during this period, but you are always with us. Lord, I pray, come be with us now. Lord, help us to know that you love us and that our prayers change eternity. And Lord, I pray, make us into a praying people that we might become a church on its knees, powerfully changing our community, Lord, and serving it as well when we can. Lord, we look to you, for you are good. Bless us now, we pray, and part us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Wow, what a wonderful word from Andy this morning. And I want us to respond to this. You know, as we've just looked at, we've opened God's word and he's just shown us the picture of the King, you know, who's defeated and conquered all. Let's just not leave it there. Let's respond. 9 years ago, when I first came to church, I heard a sermon from my brother who just preached then on prayer. And God really spoke into my heart and it totally convicted me, and it just opened up a totally different way of looking at my prayer life and stuff. And it is so important for us. And just as he said, so if you're with people, what I want us to do is we'll spend some time with Dave. We're gonna worship. We're gonna worship some more. But if there's something on your heart, if there is something you feel from this, be together and pray. If you're on your own and you're thinking, well, hold on a minute, I've got no one to pray with, then go onto the Facebook page, on the Open Door Church Facebook page, and put your number onto there, and we will get someone to phone you and pray with you. But think of some of the things that Andy said there about the lessons. What has God shown you through lockdown? And if you're struggling to slow down, then let's find someone to pray with you and ask God to be able to give you that time to slow down. You have such a wonderful, wonderful Father who loves you, adores you, and wants to spend time with you. So let's open our voices. Let's be in the center with God, and let's be together, and let's hear what God says to us, and let's move in the Spirit. So let's hand over to Dave as he brings another tune to us.
Of the morning, glorious.
Thanks, Dave. And just want to remind people as well, if you could just be praying for Chantel and her family after the death of her father. So just to keep that in your prayers. And just to thank everyone as well for praying for Ray Sivier, and the funeral went well. So just thank you so much for your time in prayer and just bringing that to God. It'd be great if you want to join us for coffee after this meeting. I know that Andy sent out an email. If you haven't got the email, I think Andy's put something on the Facebook Live page as well. So that's it. Before I finish, I just want to finish in prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this morning, Lord. Lord, we thank you for the way that you speak to us, Lord, through your work, through the worship, Lord, and through your word, Lord. And Lord, I do thank you for feeding us today, Lord. Lord, feeding us so beautifully with your word and allowing us to feel challenged in the right way, Lord, and the importance of prayer life. Lord, we lift all to the glory of Jesus, Lord, and we just ask, Lord, to know you more this time. I just pray that you'd bless and love Open Door Church and all the people, Lord, that have joined us this morning. Allow your love to be poured out on them. Allow them to know you as a father more and more. Show yourself and reveal yourself to them. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, peeps. Have a great afternoon and have a great week. And we will see you next week.